We are going to begin this course on project management today. And I'm going to give you an overview of project management in this introductory lecture. I think you are all familiar with the notion of a project. What exactly a project is, because during your course curriculum, you have done a number of projects. At home, you have probably been exposed to a variety of projects that you have undertaken on behalf of the family. But in this particular course, we are going to look at projects in a more systematic fashion and are going to identify what are the major features of a project and what exactly we would be doing in this particular course. So let us look at this issue of what is a project. This is the question. Well, a very broad definition of a project is that it is an undertaking or a venture to accomplish some goal or objective. You see, this is a very general definition, and this definition is capable of encompassing a wide variety of projects, and you can see actually that it is the broad objective or goal which tries to subsequently define what a project is all about. Let us comment on the structure of a project. A project can be viewed as a set of interrelated jobs whose accomplishment leads to the completion of the project. So essentially speaking, although here we talked about the basic objective of a project, the composition or the structure of a project is that it is composed of a variety of jobs, and these jobs are interrelated, and the completion of these jobs leads to the completion of the project. Now, because these jobs are the constituents of a project, we must understand what these jobs or activities really are. So when you view these jobs or activities, we must remember that these jobs or activities consume time and resources and are governed by precedence relations. So we have tried to look at a project from three different angles. We have tried to identify what the objective of a project is. We have tried to identify what the constituents of a project are. And then we have tried to look at the basic composition of these jobs or activities, which are very important because they are the ones which consume time and resources and are actually responsible for project completion. Let us now try to look at some examples of projects so that you get an idea of different kinds of projects and their features. There could be a variety of projects. You could talk of projects at a personal level. We can still look at some examples. We can talk of projects in the local neighborhood. We could talk about organizational projects. And we could also talk about national projects, projects done by a particular nation, projects done by a government. And we could also talk about projects at a global level. Let us try to look at some examples of these. For instance, let's try to identify some personal projects. All of you are students and are therefore very familiar with this notion of preparing for an examination. Preparing for an examination is also a very major project. It could be preparation for the JEE, or it could be preparation for the GRE, or it could be preparation for GATE, it could be preparation for the IAS examination. All that this involves is that you have to undergo a variety of tasks and activities in a systematic fashion, and all those activities together are responsible for the successful completion of the examination or whatever you are trying to do. Another example at a personal level would be writing a book. This is also an activity which would involve a large number of activities, and this is therefore also an example of a personal project. At a more personal level, even getting dressed is a project, because there are a number of clothes you have to wear, and there is a particular precedence among these clothes that you've got to wear. You've got to wear your underclothes before you wear your shirts and your trousers and things. So this also could be viewed as a personal project in that sense. Another example could be a wedding in the house. Now all of you must be familiar with this event, which must have taken place in most of your families. Now whenever a wedding takes place in the family, a large number of jobs have to be accomplished, and it involves everyone is busy doing something or the other, and this itself is a major project which has to be accomplished. Organizing a birthday function is a smaller version of a wedding where a large number of activities are involved. Organizing a family vacation is again an example of a project at a personal level. Let us now try to look at projects in the local neighborhood. Organizing a school function is a project which could be taking place in your local neighborhood. A cleanliness drive within your locality, where you probably collect donations from all the residents of the colony and then organize a cleanliness drive, is again a project. Construction of clubs for playing badminton or going for swimming, or these kinds of clubs within a locality, are again instances of projects in the local neighborhood. Let's now look at some organizational projects. Projects being carried out by the organization. Say it, one example could be construction of a building, the construction of a highway. This is an example of a project that might be undertaken by any organization. Planning and launching a new product by any organization, which would involve research and development, marketing, development, prediction, and subsequently selling the product, is again an example of a project, an organizational project. A turnaround in a refinery is a major thing, because you would not like the refinery to be closed for a long period of time. So you have to make sure that all the maintenance activities required for the refinery are done as soon as possible. And there are precedence restrictions for this, and you can think of a turnaround in the refinery as an example of an organizational project. Some instances of national projects: launching a new satellite by ISRO could be an example of a national project. A literacy campaign or a campaign to remove poverty by the government could be another example of a national project. Preparation of the annual budget by the government is again a major project. They have to consult with various sections of society. They have to talk to various entrepreneurs. They have to set their own objectives and then do this exercise every year. This again is a major project, a major national project. Some instances of global projects are organizing peace missions. These could be the kinds of projects that, for instance, Kofi Annan is currently trying to undertake when there are problems between Iraq and the United States. You have to organize these kinds of projects, and the United Nations is organizing a number of such projects at the same time. Space exploration is again an instance of a global project. I mean, most space explorations need not necessarily be done by only the United States or only by Russia. There could be collaborative ventures, and they are very massive, major projects, like rendezvous in space of certain vehicles and carrying out certain repairs of space vehicles. These are again instances of global projects which are carried out at that level. Then environment protection is again an instance of a situation where either individual countries or countries together in a group could collaborate to make sure that, for instance, the ozone layer is not disturbed, or various other things. So these are all instances of projects which are done at a global level. So what we have seen is that we have seen that projects could have a tremendous variety. They could have a small size project to a large size project. We have seen various types of examples of projects. And what we would like to therefore understand is, what is this discipline of project management that we are trying to talk about doing? What is it? What are the features of projects that we think are common to all projects? And which are those, and how do we use those features for planning, leading, controlling various kinds of projects? So now from these examples, let us try to identify some features which are common to all kinds of projects. You can see, for instance, that all these projects, the examples that we have talked about, all of them could be considered as a well-defined collection of jobs. Of course, the set of jobs would be different from one project to the other. But each project is nothing but a collection of different jobs to be done. That's the interesting thing. And it is the management of this portfolio of jobs which is really the most significant thing in a project. Then, most projects have this feature where they are generally non-repetitive and it's a one-time effort. I think this is important for us to understand, because projects are different from routine production. If you talk about mass production systems or batch production systems, their production is going on constantly and you are producing one good after another of a similar kind. For instance, the Maruti factory is producing identical Maruti cars, all true. But a project is essentially a one-time venture. I mean, the project would be setting up a factory for Maruti is a project. Once the factory is set up and handed over to the company, it is going into routine production. So remember that projects are generally non-repetitive and it's a one-time effort. Even if projects are similar, if I am constructing one flyover here, let's say in Nehru Place, another flyover at the Mehroli Road crossing, there would be differences in terms of soil testing, in terms of the detailed stresses which are built up, the structural design could be different. So though these projects could be similar, but no two projects, even of a similar kind, are generally identical. And that is, I think, one point that one has to keep in mind. And project management is essentially one activity which tries to manage this uniqueness of the project. That means for every project which is unique, we try to manage it in its own way. And project management gives us a set of tools by which this can be done. These jobs which we are talking about are essentially interrelated, but through precedence. Now, precedence, I think the notion of precedence is very common and generally well understood. For instance, you cannot do the brickwork for a house until the foundations have been completed. So in that sense, doing the foundations becomes a predecessor for doing the subsequent brickwork. Similarly, in all projects, projects are interrelated through precedence. And precedence is an important thing in trying to plan project execution. Otherwise, the jobs are independent. What this means is that although the jobs are related by precedence, but when we talk about implementing a project, the individual jobs, once the precedence restrictions are met, could be done at will. For instance, I could do the digging for the foundations now and withhold the construction subsequently. I mean, there is no time lag which is definitely required. Right? So in that sense, there is an independence of jobs. Apart from these features, the individual jobs consume both time and resources. This is important to mention. And because these jobs are the constituents of the project, which have to be managed well, Therefore, we have to make sure that the individual time and resources, in fact, these jobs or activities are the micro cost centers in a project. If you've got to control your costs and if you've got to control your durations, meet the deadlines, then you've got to make sure that these jobs, individual jobs, are done as well as possible. It's like trying to say if you want to get a very good score in your degree, you want to get a very good CGPA, you must try to do well in all the courses because the courses are the constituents of the degree. Same way, the jobs are the constituents of the project. Another important thing to bear in mind about these various jobs is that there is a tremendous amount of coordination needed between groups, individuals, and organizations as far as the project is concerned. This coordination is required because invariably these jobs could be done by different individuals. They could be subcontracted to different agencies. For instance, in a thermal power plant, for instance, the turbines could be made by one particular agency. The electrical circuitry could be made by another agency like Larsen and Toubro. And yet, when you are talking about managing the project, all these individual jobs have to be completed before the whole project is complete. So there is a great need for coordination between the various individuals and agencies handling different kinds of projects. And this is a skill which is very important when one is trying to deal with projects. I think one of the key things in project management is really the fact that there is a constant pressure of conformance to time, cost, and performance goals. Projects have to be done in time. They have to be done within the cost or at as minimum a cost as possible. And you've got to make sure that all the specifications which are required for the completion of the individual activities, they are adhered to. So basically, when one is trying to monitor the execution of a project, one must ensure that time, cost, and performance are actually monitored. And in fact, when you are talking about project implementation, we are primarily talking about monitoring and control of time and cost as well as the performance, trying to measure the performance of a project with regard to time, cost, and performance goals. So these are in fact some of the key features of a project which, no matter which project you are talking about, whether it's a personal project or an organizational project, you find these components or these features relevant. Now, let's look at a project in terms of its life cycle. I think you are all aware of the notion of a life cycle. After all, what is a project? A project is something that is done to accomplish a goal, something done to do an objective, some objective, right? The point is, really speaking, it's like this, you see. You might say, for instance, that a project is like I want to go from a current state. This is suppose I'm in, and this is where I want to go. And let's say this is my desired state. And suppose I'm currently here. So this is my current state. You can see that a project is nothing but a path that takes you from the current state to the desired state. And incidentally, there could be many such projects possible, which would possibly be able to go from the current state to the desired state. For instance, let me give you an example. Suppose I'm interested in reducing the vehicular pollution in Delhi or in any big city. There could be a number of measures that the government or any enforcing agency could think of. You might say, for instance, that there would be a severe check on the emission performance of individual vehicles. That is project P1. There could be another project, for instance, which might say that we ban the entry of new diesel vehicles, and let us say that is project P2. And a third project might be that we try to introduce some, let us say, we increase the greenery in the city. And how do we increase the greenery in the city? Say, plant more trees, things of that kind. So, afforestation drive could be a third kind of project. Each of these projects could be identified, and they could either be competing with each other or whatever they are, but they could all be viewed as nothing but paths to achieve an objective in that sense. Now, which project you take, how you define your projects is again an exercise which has to be done depending upon the economics, depending upon the resources that are at your disposal and things of that kind, and you should be able to do this particular kind of exercise. Now, each of these projects, whatever that project might be, is basically a temporary, it is intended to be a temporary thing. It's like something which will transport you from here to here, and once your journey is over, the project is over. So that is the life of every project. It is conceived, it is born, and subsequently it is executed. And once it is executed and the mission is accomplished, the project dies. So in that sense, it's like you can compare it to a kind of a journey. It has a life cycle. Now, if you look at the life cycle of a typical project, the first and the most important stage in the life of a project is the selection of the project. Now, we took up some examples just now of different projects which could be possibly conceived. And ultimately, you take one particular project which you would like to implement. The next stage would be the stage of project planning. Planning a project so that whatever you had targeted to achieve, you achieve actually. And this project planning is actually the major chunk of project management. What does this project planning involve? It involves a number of things. For instance, the first thing that it involves is determining the scope of work and then developing a network to represent all the activities. So we develop the scope of work, what all has to be done, right? In each of the three projects which we just talked about for vehicular pollution, you have to define exactly as to what is going to be your target area. And how are you exactly going to do the work? So you define the scope of work, and once the scope of work is defined, you identify exactly which are the individual jobs and you develop a network for doing this. The next basic activity in project planning is what they call basic scheduling. We'll talk about this in a little greater detail later on, but basic scheduling is intended to determine essentially the time schedule. When should what activity be done? Are there flexibilities in doing various activities? Things of this nature. And then there are issues of time cost trade-offs. That is, a project can normally be done within a year. Can we do it in 9 months instead by maybe putting in more resources, more money? These kinds of issues are answered in time cost trade-offs. They're very vital issues because quite often you might be interested in shortening projects by investing more money if it is worthwhile to do so. And then we can talk about the various resource considerations in projects like manpower and the availability of machines and various other resources required for doing the project. So essentially, project planning deals with these things. Once a plan is made, the next thing is project implementation, which is so-called the third phase of the project life cycle, where the project is actually implemented. So it involves basically the expenditure of resources, doing work at site, coordinating between various people and agencies, and things of this kind. And after the project is implemented, the last stage would be project completion and audit. Once the project has been completed successfully, you might like to document your experiences and you might want to do an audit to find out as to, so that you might even use this information as a data bank for planning future projects. in that sense. So this constitutes essentially the life cycle of a project. Now let's look at each of these stages in little greater detail, because that is exactly the job of project management. So during this course of project management, we'll be looking at, for instance, project selection, which is the first phase. We already talked about project selection. It essentially involves three things: project identification, identification of new projects, their appraisal, and finally the selection of the best project. Project identification really involves that anybody who is interested in identifying a new project should be receptive to new ideas. It's very important, because the idea for a new project can come from anywhere. It could come from the marketing people, it could come from top management, it could come from the production people, or it could come from a consumer who has been dealing with your project and is therefore aware of the problems that your project is really facing. You should have a vision of future growth. That's very important, because it's a problem, it's something like dreaming into the future to find out exactly what you're going to do. So vision of future growth is very important. You should be clear about your long-term objectives. If you are in the steel industry, would you like to stay within the steel industry, or would you like to diversify into the electronic sector, or would you like to do something else? So these kinds of issues become very, very important. A SWOT analysis, a strength, weakness, opportunities and threat analysis, to find out what are my current weaknesses, what are the strengths that I have accumulated over the years, what are the opportunities which the market is offering me now, and what are the threats. A systematic analysis of this will help you identify the right projects. A project identification is really very important. And of course, on the basis of this, you would be able to do some preliminary project analysis. And basically, this project analysis will help you in ultimately identifying which out of the 10 or 20 odd projects that you have identified, which one you should be pursuing in greater detail. So after the project identification, the next phase is the phase of project appraisal. Project appraisal is generally initiated with a market appraisal, finding out what the market is, what are the needs and of the market, what is the scope for the new product, and things of that nature. A market appraisal is followed with a technical appraisal. A technical appraisal is followed by typically a financial appraisal of the project. And a financial appraisal is followed by an economic appraisal, which talks of the broader issues, and an ecological appraisal, talking about how this would affect the environment, how the project would affect the environment, and things of this kind. And basically, all these appraisals are required before you make a feasibility report. A feasibility report considers all these issues prior to project adoption. So a project feasibility report, which is a very important document, which actually identifies how the project is, why the project is selected, what is the profitability, and things of this nature, is actually a document which is talking about the various kinds of project appraisals, so that a proper decision on project selection could be made. Let's look at some of the issues involved in these various appraisals. A market appraisal, for instance, will talk about things like what is the aggregate future demand of the product, the total demand for tires, right? Maybe if you're talking about entering the tire market. What is likely to be your market share? This is again an estimate which would have to be made. And what is the state of the current and the future competition in the area? You got to assess these things. What is the location and accessibility of consumers? You have a consumer who is located at one particular location, or you have a consumer who is spread out geographically over a whole region. because an understanding of this is going to be very important, because consumers have to be targeted, located and accessed for not only their opinion, but even ultimately the product has to go to them in that sense. What is the current technological scenario, and how long does obsolescence last? I mean, when does obsolescence take place? See, for instance, in the electronic sector, obsolescence rates are very high. A product right now, you have newer models of the product in electronics, newer computers coming up in less than 3 months, 6 months. Whereas if you talk about capital machinery and so on, the rate of obsolescence is relatively smaller. So these issues are important when you're trying to talk about products. What are the possible pricing options? So these are some of the major issues that one would like to handle or like to talk about when one is talking about a market appraisal. Similarly, a technical appraisal will talk about things like engineering aspects, locations, size and the production process. And a financial appraisal would talk about things like cash flows over time, profitability of the product, break-even point, net present value, the internal rate of return, the payback period and the risk. All these things together would give us an indication of the financial health of the project. Now, if you compare this with the economic appraisal of a project, an economic appraisal incidentally would talk about issues of greater concern to the society at large, socio-economic benefits. So when we would talk about the benefits and costs, not necessarily in monetary terms, but in terms of their shadow prices. What we mean by shadow prices really is, for instance, if you have a hydroelectric project and you are utilizing land, and land will probably have to be acquired from society, right? You know, Meda Patkar, for instance, is making a huge issue of this particular Narmada Dam. And the whole issue really is that if a proper socio-economic analysis is carried out, you would probably be able to find as to what would be the true benefits per hectare of land which is actually taken up from the villagers. And you should take up this project only when the benefits are in fact benefits warrant that this particular investment in resources be made in terms of shadow prices. So this is the kind of thing. What is the effect on distribution of income in society? What are the level of savings and investments in society? These kinds of issues are important. Self-sufficiency, employment and social order. These are also employment and these are also important, because most projects, if I set up a factory for manufacturing tires, I'm actually generating avenues for employment for people in that area, right? So these are the kinds of issues which come up when you're talking about a broad economic appraisal of any project. And when, for instance, a national project or a global project is being considered, these issues would become very relevant. Issues pertaining to the environment are assuming greater and greater importance. So an ecological appraisal of projects is also very important. We should assess as to what is the extent of environmental damage that is likely to come about by setting up this particular project. What is this damage to the quality of air, to the quality of water? How is it going to contribute to noise levels and to other measures as far as the environment is concerned? So there could be legislation on a number of these factors, that this is the kind of level of air permitted, or the level of carbon monoxide or various other pollutants in the air permitted. But you have to be careful. So the essence really is that you got to be concerned, or you got to be careful about any environmental damages, and especially you got to be talking about restoration measures and the kind of costs that are involved in restoration. If you are going to dirty the air or you're going to dirty the adjoining rivers, you probably have to make sure that you do a filtration, set up a filtration plant to actually clean up the remaining thing. So there is a cost of restoration of the quality of the environmental life. So these are also some issues pertaining to an appraisal. So we have talked about broadly some of these major issues involved in the appraisal of a project, which involves various functions. Once a project is appraised or projects are appraised, how do we select a project? So we finally come to this stage of project selection, which is in fact the first stage where the birth of the project has taken place. So some of the criteria which are important in project selection are the investment, the rate of return, risk, likely profit, payback, and issues like similarity to existing business. This is important because you may want to utilize the experience that you have gained in a particular profession in setting up or in propagating your new project. What is the expected life of this project? What kinds of flexibilities does it afford to you? What is the environmental impact? We all talked about these issues. Competition. What is the status of competition? So conceptually, when we talk about these issues, there are multiple criteria. So really speaking, the problem is one of multi-criteria evaluation. So conceptually, we can say that there are a number of projects, let's say P1, P2, and so on up to PM. There are M projects which we have identified, and we want to weigh them on a variety of criteria which we just discussed, C1, C2, and so on up to CN. And what you could possibly be doing is, you could probably be assigning greater weights to these criteria. So we have a weight W1, W2, and so on up to WN to these individual criteria. And what we would like to do is that each of these projects would be evaluated on each of these criteria and given some score on each of these various criteria. And then depending upon the weightages which are there for these individual criteria, we could work out a consolidated score for each of the projects. So S1 is a score for the project, S2 is a score for the second project, and SM is a score for the mth project. A variety of means are available for doing this, but remember that this is very much like the process of assigning marks to students in a university. For instance, you are the candidates, and each one of you undergoes through various courses. These courses have certain weightages. Your performance in each of these courses is ultimately combined to give an overall score, and therefore we can rank the individual students in a university. So we are essentially trying to use similar types of concepts in trying to rank these various projects. So multi-criteria evaluation of projects can be done in this particular way using a decision matrix approach. And there are various other techniques like TOPSIS, like simple additive weighting or hierarchical additive weighting, which can be utilized for carrying out this kind of analysis. Let's now come to the second phase of the project, which is project planning. Project planning involves forming a project team with a leader, defining the scope and terms of reference of the work breakdown structure, developing the work breakdown structure, doing basic scheduling, time cost trade-offs, and subsequently resource considerations. So this is the gamut of project planning. Let's look at these activities in greater detail. Basic scheduling, for instance, talks about project representation as a network, estimation of activity durations, doing a forward and backward pass and ultimately determining the critical path and the floats. And this critical path is a vehicle which is used for selective control, and it identifies the minimum possible project duration. So in that sense, this provides some very useful guidelines to management on how the project is to be done. In time cost trade-offs, for instance, our concern is with trying to identify the flexibility in activity durations. So we talk about normal and crash activity durations. There could be various kinds of relationships: linear, non-linear, discontinuous, discrete, time cost relationships. And the objective is to discover ultimately the project cost duration efficient frontier, and from here to identify the total project cost consisting of both the direct and the indirect costs. So there are a number of procedures available for doing this kind of thing. Then I would like to just talk about some aspects of resources specifically. We can talk about resource aggregation, which talks about determining the project schedule, resource consumption profile for each resource, provisioning of resources over time, basically aggregating all the resources so that you know what is the total resource requirement, and then process of leveling these resources by shifting the jobs which have slack to obtain a balanced resource profile, keeping the project duration fixed. And there are a variety of hand and computer procedures available which we will be discussing as we go along in this particular course. Limited resource allocation is another thing which is extremely important, which talks about the minimum duration schedule satisfying the limited availability of resources, which might involve delaying some critical jobs to keep the resource profile within the available limits. And there are again a number of hand and computer procedures available for doing this. Here is a pictorial representation of the process. In resource aggregation, we are simply interested in finding out what is going to be the manner in which resources are utilized over time. In resource leveling, we are not increasing the project duration, but we are trying to shift some jobs so that this becomes more leveled. Now, we might have a certain limited availability of resources, and this might be violating that limited availability. So we might have to delay some of the jobs so that all this resource peaks come within the limited availability. So this is what we mean by limited resource allocation, where the project duration tends to increase a little bit beyond the critical path duration. But the objective is to keep this increase to the minimum. Now, when one talks about project implementation, the next phase, the major phase, issues involved here are organizing your team and work, clear time cost performance goals, project monitoring with regard to cost, value of work and time, and project control. These are some of the major issues when one talks about project completion, project implementation, sorry. In project completion, issues are disbanding of the project team. The job is over, so people go to their respective places or respective units, handing over of the project to the user, accounting and report writing, and learning from the experience. These are some of the issues which are important when you're talking about project completion. Now, the important thing to bear in mind here is that if any project which is done, there can be a number of problems. Typically, these problems can be at the organizational level or the behavioral level, financial problems, legal problems, engineering problems, problems at site of construction or installation of a particular machine. That could be a problem. There could be problems of site evacuation or development of the site, labor unrest or the unavailability of labor, non-availability of resources, weather conditions, or ad hoc on-the-spot improvisations. I think this is a particular feature of projects, that you don't know exactly what's in store for you, and you have to go ahead with these kinds of improvisations. Apart from these typical problems, human issues in project management are of great concern. What is really required is working together in teams, proper communication, conflict management, leadership and motivation. You should have a leader who is able to motivate you, the proper organizational structure. It is said that matrix organizations are the best organizations for projects. So we'll see what is so special about matrix organizations. Selection of the project manager. These are important issues. Finally, I'd just like to talk about, before I close, about issues in computers in project management. Computers have come up in a big way, so we should know exactly what is their primary use in project management. Computers are used primarily for easy sorting and listing of activities. Now, this is a very great skill, because if you have, let's say, 5,000 activities or jobs, you can prepare lists either department wise or specialty wise or according to the times at which the activities are to be undertaken. This is a great skill. So sorting and listing of activities is itself of great convenience. Easy updation and new listings of project progress over the life cycle. You don't have to draw the project network only once. As the project progresses, various activities are completed and you've got to do this again and again. So this is very convenient. And certain advanced analysis like time cost trade-offs and resource considerations like resource leveling and resource allocation are practical only with computer programs. And there are many commercially available packages. MS Project is one example. Of course, there are other examples like Harvard Project Manager, Primavera, and so on, which are commercially available for doing this particular thing. So computers are in fact a blessing to project management because they help in effective implementation of the project. So let us try to see what we have tried to do in this particular project. Let's try to summarize what we have learnt in this particular lecture, the first introductory overview. We have seen the definition of a project and we have seen examples of different kinds of projects. It's one thing. So you understand the diversity of projects and you know what are their common features. We have tried to identify some key features of projects. Some of these key features are important because they define the major elements on which project management is based. We have talked about the life cycle of a project. We have talked about the various phases in the life cycle, starting from project selection, project planning, project scheduling, project implementation, and project completion, and the kinds of problems which come up at these individual stages. Finally, we have tried to look at some typical project problems, problems associated with projects. We have seen that the problems could be very varied in their content, starting from human to technical to behavioral problems. We have identified some of the human issues in project management, the importance of working in teams, things of that kind. And finally, we have seen how computers help in project management. So I hope that this, if you have any questions, you're welcome to ask. Okay, thank you.